gentlemen, we are ready to now welcome Sarnath Banerjee and in conversation with him, Kishore Bhimani.
Just between good morning and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, we start at this very auspicious hour. What is very unusual task, that of explaining or justifying the graphic novel, finding out perhaps some of the origins, comparing it with things, but two or three controversial points which we shall talk as we go along. Sarnath Banerjee, Probashi Bangali, but a little bit in Calcutta, a little bit outside, a little bit rest of the world. Probashi writer, he's also been an advertising man, as is usual in this profession. I don't think you can fill your belly writing. So one way or another, I will take the liberty of starting off this thing and let Sarnath explain to you, in brief, as starters, what is a graphic novel?
Oh. You put me on a back foot. First of all, thank you very much for speaking to me. I was just telling Mala that if I had tried to speak to Kishore Bhimani on an airport, he would have run away from me. But now in a captive stage, he cannot run away so easily. So a man who encompasses and kind of also holds an entire history, kind of growing up and all the good things before terrible regionalization of our cultures and the whole idea of modernity, you know, that there were all these modern voices that existed within our modern yet not Western at the same time. So I'm very happy that I have you. Maybe I'll ask the questions. But I'll try to answer your question. There is nothing particularly specific about graphic novels. It's a term that actually have acquired a kind of an annoying quality these days because a large number of people are sort of giving visual representation to different forms of literature and calling it graphic novels. It's just basically comic books suited and booted, I suppose, made respectable, ready for the races. Nothing sort of intriguing or... yeah, it's just comic books.
I'll take on from here.
All right.
We were chatting a little earlier as a sort of prelude to this event, inverted commas. One of the things is I asked Sarnath a very simple question. Comic books, I've grown up on a diet, since it does date me, but it doesn't really matter, of Superman, Captain Marvel, and a whole lot of Spider-Man came much later, and then there were all other kind of superheroes. And we got quite used to the idea of the bubble, as they called it, where the words are, and the individual who seems to do all kinds of things. The point is, what did it achieve? It achieved people who didn't have the lung power to continue with reading normal books. They would see the pictures. I remember when I was in school, St. Xavier's, it's very interesting. We used to all collect comics. Fawcett was the publisher, and this thing called Captain Marvel, Captain Marvel Jr., Mary Marvel, no, how many more would have come? Captain Marvel with a scarf, Captain Marvel with, all kinds of things. Now, some of my friends said, I would say, have you read this comic? Now, we would smuggle that into school, pass it around, have exchange sessions. And some of the boys would say, yeah, I've looked at that one. I said, hello? I mean, don't you read comics? Now, this is very interesting. Because what happens now, I would like to, let us say, preface my remarks by saying that having gone through Sarnath's book, A, you have to read it, B, there's a vast difference, what they call sea change, between that era and this era, and I was absolutely stunned. Now, this is all about water wars, this particular book. It's about social causes. It's about some of the abuse of bureaucracies. And all this weaved into a very childlike pattern of a comic. To me, that was my take-home quality of this. And what I would like to ask Sarnath this age, this stage, do you believe that the habit of reading, which is fast disappearing, believe it or not, it's fast disappearing. I was telling him the story about a party we'd had, and after a certain amount of liquid had gone down the system, I got very courageous, and I said, if there is one person in this room who has read The Golden Gate from start to finish and swears that he's done it, I'll give up drinking. I've read it, you know, first 10 pages, 20 pages. In fact, I stopped, and then I was traveling to Delhi and I couldn't read it and all that. In very simple terms, ladies and gentlemen, believe me, very few people read these days. They come to functions like this, enjoy any kind of literary back chat, interplay and so on and so forth, go home and say, I must read that book sometime, and that's it. Now here, what I would want to ask you is this going to be a game-changing thing?
First of all, you quite rightly spoke about reading, and particularly reading fiction. It's not that people are reading less. It's that reading, having piecemeal sort of reading experiences like snatches of this and that they pick up from the internet, and a lot of, like, there are all these sites called brain pickings and things like that. So you kind of get a chunk of knowledge which you could like use later or for conversation purposes or writing a proposal or art kind of thing. And it's particularly relevant within the art world where people pick up like eFlux, they would kind of, you know, read an article there and that kind of gets translated. Then there is, of course, a rise in nonfiction, particularly in the city that I come from. There's a new thing called literary reportage, which is basically you take a single subject and then you examine it. Whether it requires examination or not, you still can continue, you bang on for 24 pages of writing this sort of literary nonfiction kind of a thing. Well, often they're very good, but sometimes you wonder, that man is an amazing climber. See, we don't notice nice things in life, you know, sometimes.
Wouldn't this make a lovely opening picture in your book?
Uh-huh. But if we make him conscious, he might fall. So, the problem is that, and then there's a reticence towards reading fiction, because often what happens is two things have happened. One is because people think, look, I don't want to read another lilting prose from sort of cloud-filled Shillong, somewhere in some college, and my achy big, you know, like the sort of, you know, pain and hurt and things like that. And after like, you know, 40, 50 pages, I mean, I would assume that Golden Gate probably after those 40 pages still continues to kind of grip you with other things than just sort of, you know. But a lot of people don't read fiction, says that, you know, why should we read it? Because it's another, you know, the third argument is that we'd rather read fiction by, like, written by, you know, years, people who had like written fiction before. We first have to finish that. I feel fiction has a transformative quality. It actually makes a person more sensitive and empathetic to the world, and more sensitive to things that are happening around. Like this water war, the idea came, because I happened to read many years back a book called Last Jet Engine Smile, which is, the author is right here, Ruchit Joshi. There was a brief mention of this sort of water war. Not a brief, but a few chapters. And it also included one of our friends as a central character who was part of this. And that stuck. And, you know, what fiction essentially does is, like, it actually helps us to sort of, you know, calibrate our mind, or like nonfiction is just like, it's just like information. Informations don't really. So that, if that answers one part of your question, as far as game changing, whether graphic novel is going to be a game changer or not, I think graphic novel is not fundamentally, at least the ones I write or what the other, my colleagues write, they're not like for like mass appeal. They're not, we are not writing a, even if we write a story of the discovery of the reverse swing, of how Sarfaraz Nawaz might have spent like afternoons practicing his reverse swing in a cricket pitch in Lahore. It will be all about like the internal dynamics of Sarfaraz Nawaz, you know, traumatized by his high pitched voice and trying to do something with the ball. I mean, it might not appeal to a large group of people, management schools who want to like improve themselves by reading books to kind of get to the next level of consciousness. It's all about like a kind of extended bit of normal life. That's all.
Well, I come back to my original question, which I was trying to explore. The point is, I got this book from Mala 2 days ago, and I promise you, I read it till the end. That is why it started me thinking. The 3 or 4 books recently, which my wife, who has more patience than I have, Colin Rye's book, for example, it's so thick that to pick it up after a while, my muscles were aching. So I said, you can only read little at a time. I didn't finish it. I'm ashamed to admit, a good book started off well. First 40 pages were great, but I couldn't carry on. Now, this is the thing. I'm not saying it's a game-changing thing in that people will look for qualities different here, but it's easier reading. Now, it's easier reading if somebody is writing on behalf of Arvind Kejriwal about the water condition in Delhi, about the indiscipline in the Congress party, about how he is the eternal victim. I mean, his book would be titled The Eternal Victim. But the fact remains that if he did it, if Sarnath wrote that book and made him into, especially that muffler, it could be such a wonderful identification. And, you know, I would read it and smile occasionally, and you could get across a biting message of what this is all about. Now, why are people not reading? I've been I used to do book reviews for various publications, and I believe that there was a certain amount of sanctity, protocol, call it a moral obligation if you like, of reading the book. And I would not attempt, I would go to my boss at that time in the Statesman days, Mr. Emerson, and say, Mr. Emerson, I haven't got it ready. I still have to finish a few pages. Now, if I get a book, I promise you I don't want to, but if somebody wants me to review something, there was a book that came to me the other day on match fixing. For my sins associated with cricket for some reason or other, but and that came to me. And what I did was I went to page 1, page 27, 103, and it was 190 pages. I said, I'll read 4 pages in all. Mm-hmm. I came to the conclusion that the gentleman concerned doesn't understand match fixing. He thinks that 11 players have to be called, drilled, told what to do, and they would fix a match. Now, obviously, we are the people on the inside. And, the point is people are not reading. I really, really believe, I do this on my own to find out that people have read books. I launched a book recently, a couple of years ago, and somebody, the subjects in it, I dealt with the subject of Kashmir. I believe in Azad Kashmir, and I said it, and I even checked with if I could be held up for sedition or not. When I asked somebody who claimed to have read the book that, how did you react to this Kashmir thing? I haven't read a book on Kashmir recently. I said, never mind, I understand now. So this thing, Sarnath, I really want to know. Game changing means what? People are going to start, this has happened in, now who was the first writer? We had Will Eisner, wasn't it, in 1978. That was The Contract with God. It's a very lyrical sort of name. Now, what I mean is you're carrying a bit of a responsibility of people picking up books again instead of going to television. And, all these people who are advertising Kindle, trying so hard. It comes on via the readers and via whatever it is. What about this? Do you think you can do something better than that?
I don't know whether I can do it better than that. I do agree with what you were saying, that everything that is every sort of gently put together in kind of sort of idea that is just about to come out, you know, like in a sort of in its infancy, would often be taken by sort of these marketing people and then suddenly dressed up and embellishes this next big thing, and then suddenly there are like big festivals happening around a form that could have actually had to only, there are only certain things that only happen in darkness, in relative obscurity. So like, for example, when the streets of Paris was lit up, there was a whole lot of protests about, like, when electric light came to Paris. He said, like, there are certain bits of Paris that could only happen, that certain things, activities could only happen when there is isolation. Similarly, if you look at South African art and literature, a lot of it actually happened because it was away from the gaze of mainstream sort of, you know. So I enjoyed this, or maybe it was my way of, like, you know, handling relative obscurity. But I seem to, like, enjoy the fact that it was something that I was developing. The moment there is a promise of, like, something beyond what it is, I feel people start, like, you know, you are actually sort of bringing the end, you know, that's the nasty, that is all going to sort of, you know, fizzle out into, I don't have to somehow adhere to this sort of big, the bigness of things. I'm quite happy with this smaller aspect. Like, you know, 5,000, 10,000 people read a comic book, it does my, I can digest my quiche. But
yeah, one, the other thing was, how did you start? Did you start in with the images, or did you write not ordinary prose before?
Everything I write is fairly ordinary.
No, so, no, I meant ordinary prose as opposed to graphic prose.
Words only. Yeah, I failed miserably at it. I couldn't write a single sentence without a grammatical mistake, and I couldn't even get my thought together. It's a different sport. We're talking about badminton and squash. I'll let you decide which one is badminton, which one is squash. But comic books mistakenly has always been either brought into the visual world, because I also have a life within the world of visuals, because I do show my work, and there's the literary world, such as this situation. I think comics does not belong to either of these worlds.
Can we go back?
I'll tell you which world it does belong to, though. it belongs to the compositional world. It is it's like, you know, you just think of Ravindra Jain, the blind, brilliant music director with a harmonium. And he would write a few notes, then he'll play it. I mean, his assistant will write it down. And then some of the notes he would sort of, you know, recite, this is, write down, and he'll play it. And he'll say, this is shit. I mean, Ravindra Jain doesn't use those kind of words. But he'll say, ye bura hai, or something. And then he'll play again, write and play, write. And then something will come out of it. And I can't remember a Ravindra Jain tune right now, but I knew all of them were very amazing. And that's how good comics comes out. You know, constantly like trial and error of like using. And that's how I started also, because I also, it helped the fact that everything else I did till then, I'd been phenomenally mediocre at, which included filmmaking.
Well, yeah, I was saying, Sarnath, we go back to the origin of these things. Now, two of the epoch-making, earth-shaking, worldwide popular comic strips, I don't mind calling them graphic novels, because they're full books, Tintin and Asterix. Tintin has, beginning to talk about it, it's become a novel language. The language of Tintin, everyone knows who Captain Haddock is, people know about Thompson with a P and Thompson without a P, people know all these stories about Professor Haddock and Professor Calculus and his absent-mindedness, and Castafiore's Emerald, another one that this talked about, this lady singer. And a lot of education was imparted through that. people came to know a little bit about opera music. They came to know about how ships sail, how people drink, and how not to use swear words. That's why we brought in thousands of blistering barnacles. And, you know, the point was, it was very interesting. When I was young and I used to read those, and I used to say, but I wouldn't have quite said that. A sailor would say that? Blistering barnacles? He would say something. I know better swear word than that. He shouldn't. And even Sarnath, his book, believe it, he would never say blistering barnacles. When he wanted to say something, he says it. Believe it or not, you got to read this book and see it. They're lovely, expressive words. Those expressive Anglo-Saxon words have no substitute. They cannot be whatever you might choose to call it. That was Tintin. Asterix was educated even me. I thought I was educated. I thought I'd been to college, I'd been to school, I'd read so widely, and yet I never heard of Vercingetorix. And a lot of people who can't even pronounce Vercingetorix, and when one of the characters in the Asterix books gets drunk, he has 16 different pronunciations for that. And he's trying to say it, and he said, who's the general, the Gauls? It's supposed to be Vercingetorix, and he calls him Vercingetorix, Vercingetorix, and, you know, very geriatrix. I mean, absolutely amazing. These things today, the history of the Romans, the Gauls, it starts the other way around, sort of inductive process where you read something about this, and then you want to read the real history because it sounds so good. But what I was going to come to was, it is so worldwide, so popular, so prevalent in different languages, in different... I came across, believe it or not, a spoof version, a naughty version of Tintin. A whole book with everything exaggerated. You had, of course, the Thompsons, for example. I can tell you one of the lesser things. The Thompsons were more interested in each other than members of the opposite sex, and so it went. The sailor had certain things to do. The point, it had become something, a spoof that is so popular, because I suppose the original is worldwide. How much relevance does the era of those comics have on you, on your publication, or on reading habits?
Tintin specifically has been remarkably important in the way, even now, it's reached the... Tintin has set kind of a grammatical standard of how to do a certain kind of comics, which I think all of us attempted at some point in time to do. You were talking about the language of comics earlier, because I think this is exactly what we're trying to do, that you actually stumble upon the language of comics, which Hergé or George Remy did, and a phenomenal amount of educational aspect of it. But like, for example, you know, you get to know about marine sciences, so to say. I mean, there was Jacques Cousteau happening. Parallelly, you are growing up with Tintin, all these sort of maritime words, and then like polar invasion, and sort of, you know, it creates, often people say that, you know, images can actually stop you from imagining things. But I do feel that images can actually also open up, you know, that I still tell stories of the Yeti to my little son, which are like kind of drawn from Tintin, the Tintin way of looking at things. And Tintin also bases a lot of his work on real events. George Remy never actually stepped out of Europe all his life. I mean, he might have been once to China or something like that. But he kind of created that entire thing. He had a whole studio of people who acquired all these sort of cuttings and things like that. And he was abreast with everything. Asterix, I can't tell you much about, because I'm not very well read when it comes to Asterix. But Tintin, definitely. My problem is that I'm finding increasing the real reality of things difficult to talk about. Like, you were talking about Mr. Kejriwal's policies, or all the things that are happening in Delhi, and the environment problems, water problems and all that. I can only understand the world, and this is, I think, a disease of sorts, in terms of unreal ways, or maybe if I want to use slightly more charismatic word, more like sort of surreal kind of approach to understanding things, which is also goes back to the earlier discussion about fiction. I feel that fiction can actually somehow bring you closer to a tonality. So, for example, if you've met Dennis Lilly at some point of time in your life, or whoever, one of the sort of iconic figure, I would, if I'm interviewing you and I'm trying to create that as a graphic novel, I would go down to your socks and try to create those details. That are the Burberry socks, is that tweed, and what kind of sort of, you know, atmosphere within which this conversation was taking place? Were birds chirping outside? Was this jerk chicken being, you know, where are these guys from West Indies? Did they bring all their sort of the seven stripe beers and eat jerk chicken around Oval Stadium during the good old time of cricket, you know, with the sort of, you know, maroon caps and white. Now, the thing is that comics as a language, I'm sure, like, there are good writers who could write a very nice descriptive. People have written about Kentucky Derby, for example, beautifully, and people have written about boxing, as we know, Hunter Thompson. But comics has a natural tendency to almost like a Japanese Zen garden kind of a thing, where everything is all happening at the same time, the simultaneity of all. A lot of people have problems trying to understand that simultaneity. Ke ye bhi ho raha hai, wo bhi ho raha hai, wahan pe piche bhi wo ho raha hai. And he's dressed up like George Smiley. You know, that one word that, you know, Burberry's and stuff like that. Otherwise, the person walks in. So these things, comics is a map of a tonality map of a particular thing, and that is what makes that medium kind of.
I recall very briefly, since Sarnath seems to have juggled my memory a bit, is when there was a very famous movie. My one of my favorite writers, all time favorite writers, has been and always will be John Le Carre, and his apart from the spy novels that we talk about, it's his language, it's the characters he creates. They're unforgettable, George Smiley, but a whole lot of characters he's created in different books. And one of the things was when Le Carre, he does the things of his own movies. When they make a movie out of a Le Carre novel, he does he actually likes to do the screenplay with a person who's a screenplay expert, but he'll do it. And I remember one of them, The Tailor of Panama. My favorite book of his will always be The Constant Gardener, where he deals with the dumping of unusable medicine in African countries. But Tailor of Panama, he said, after it was finished and after he had seen it, his comment was, it's almost as if I had written a graphic novel. You know, he could picturize what he thought of the Tailor of Panama, the whole battle, the politics, the American imperialism, and, you know, the people who fight and people who create. It's absolutely amazing. And that, you know, I remember that when this whole graphic novel thing came through, I remember that comment. And I said, you know how it is. And it is so real that when we read a book, if I read a Le Carre book, I will read it on force. I'll even forget my meals, forget everything else, and finish it. But yet, sometimes I wish I could read it in comic forms. See what they look like. See what George Smiley really looks like. Mm. See what all the other characters. Toby Esterhazy, you know, the Hungarian eccentric. And sometimes you wonder about that. And that's why, as I said, I was very interested in this. I must confess, a week ago, I didn't know anything about it. I had read about Sarnath, of course, on the net, but didn't know very much about graphic knowledge or novels or graphic writing. Now we come to the other thing, something that...
Can I quickly add about George Smiley? What makes him very intriguing is what he dresses up, his clothes. And I'm extremely intrigued by what people wear. Fashion is perhaps the only one thing that I'm singularly interested in, apart from music, and how people wear and what they wear and the little history behind what they wear is what John Le Carre had it down. So, I mean, if one just writes a little essay about what is George Smiley going to wear, because the reason we are having this conversation with George Smiley is because you're looking like George Smiley right now. So, and why? So we could have had this conversation with Zina Tawan, but I'm saying that John Le Carré. So this is precisely the joy of doing comics. There's an enormous amount of joy in what we do. Otherwise, why do comics? You know, it takes a long time to do it. You don't make any money. Nobody's really particularly interested except for that small group of people who read you. There's no logical or, you know, if you go by management school reasons, there's absolutely no reason to do comics. But we still do it because there's a pure, like, it's like the same amount of joy of, like, having a kulfi and rallies. I don't know whether it's still open. You can have one after another and just, like, feel that. And that joy is important to one. It's rather bleak if you're not having fun. No? Otherwise, life is generally...
Just a last word on Le Carré. I always wondered what Kala would look like. You know, book after book, Smiley's People, Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, a whole lot of books where he, where you see this shadowy presence of Kala. And one of the lesser people asks Smiley, is Kala a beautiful woman? And he looks at him and says, much more dangerous than a beautiful woman. And you sometimes wonder, what does Kala look like? And what happened was, in that movie, Smiley's People, you know, when they had this TV series in on the BBC, and they showed him for 15 seconds crossing the bridge on the River Spray, Checkpoint Charlie, where he's actually crossing over, and they've got the camera on him. It remains on the bicycle on which he has come. He throws the bicycle down, and he moves down towards the West Berlin, and then you see his face for 15 seconds. I said, don't do this to us. We want to know what it looks like. Yeah. Anyway, I was coming to something a little more serious, Arnath. It's about the some of the causes that you pick up, which really started me thinking about Arvind Kejriwal. The causes you pick up, water wars. This book is about water wars. People who, it has happened in Delhi. These are realities. Of water vans being hijacked, of people being assaulted, of people meeting and some set of lesser people complaining that the Lutyens is Delhi and the better areas are getting water, that there have been fights over it. And here in this, a young man starts digging for water. What is he looking for? Yet another interesting fact is the mythical river Saraswati. Saraswati is a river that is mentioned in the scriptures, not in the scriptures, in mythology, in kind of folklore, and it doesn't exist. All of us were fired. When I was a kid, my grandmother used to tell me stories about the Ganga, Jamuna, Saraswati. And where is Saraswati? Well, it doesn't exist. I asked once my hero, Professor P. Lal, what about Saraswati? He said, you read the whole of Bhagavad Gita, you read the whole of thing, and you'll get an idea that it's something elusive. Now, he sets out in the thing of Saraswati. All the action takes place around that. There are people with very cute names, like Rastogi. You think he's a bureaucrat in Delhi, who's looking very evil and very undefinable. And I really thought, to me, the greatest take-home value of this book or this kind of thing was illustrated examples of a lot of things that happen, how the rich treat the poor. I was going to ask him a question which I've resisted even before the program. I didn't ask him, but I think some of his values are very leftist. Now remember and he talks about rich people, he makes sketches of rich people that look evil. They look like what I thought Kala would look like. And the poor people look cute. And and really, you know, it is a commitment. If you're a writer, you can conceal this. Can you conceal it if you're an illustrator? As he says, illustrates. He writes and they think it's mediocre. I mean, what?
I'm very fond of people of Delhi. I'm I'm a product of like all the people I hang around with, like from your juice wala to your property dealer. I think they all, there's a word in Bengali called kore khacche, which means they're all sort of somehow, you know, they are in they're intrepid and they are entrepreneurial and they're dynamic and they are always trying to kind of get to do something and they're always. And there's also a phenomenal charm in which how Delhi people behave and their morning rituals and how they go to sleep and their evening rituals of playing badminton and, you know, all that is great. But there's also a martial aspect to Delhi people. There is a it kind of usually comes, is expressed every evening during parking time when they come back from. So, since you can't stack up cars, I think we've been asked to ask questions. No, stack up cars. In the absence of that, you, and then there are all these sort of high, so you're in the all constantly in the company of extremely disreputable men, some women as well. And I love that. I love this sort of fixing and things like that. Now this, all these characters, Rastogi included, who's like a villainous, they're all done with a degree of love, I think, I feel for people in Delhi. And what I do get annoyed, like I used to live in Panchshil, the horrible upper middle class of Delhi is my big gripe, which is basically they've actually even injected their own class system into the staff. So the driver is, if he's a driver of SUV, he's slightly higher up than a driver of like your regular car, and who's bigger than a gardener. Then the cook kind of comes somewhere halfway through, and the last was the jamadarni. So if you walk around Panchshil, around those sort of, you know, you find sort of bits and bobs of that kind of Delhi. But by and large, it's an amazing city. And even whilst I have made Greta Kailash fight Jorbagh or Jangpura get into war with Defense Colony or Swaminagar having its own nuclear reactor or, you know, people putting carcasses like a Bhishma Sahani story into somebody else's tanker, trying and blaming it on, or snipers shooting early morning pump open, like, poor guys, 4 o'clock, you wake up. And it's like Judaic. The firstborns are usually asked to go out and put the pump on at 4 in the morning. Cause it's very depleting exercise. And then if you've done that reasonably well, you're free for the rest of the day. So these are lovely things about Delhi, which I like. And this war is just an excuse. I think we should take some questions.
Yeah. Oh,
we've got about 10 minutes.
We got a bit carried away. Maybe we should now think of any questions you may have on either general aspects of...
Or gender issues. I can talk about issues. Gender issues.
Yes, sir. Mr. Kripalani wants a mic.
Hi,
thank you,
Sarnath.
Hello.
I'm amazed at the surprise Mr. Bhimani showed, and you up to a point, about the advent of the graphic novel. I was 4 years old and reading classic illustrated comics, so there's nothing new about the graphic novel, okay? I mean, about its advent, that's the question I wanted to put. Why do you feel that it's a new thing?
Well, Jayant has always been a precocious kind of he's now precocious, so when he was younger, he was also precocious, I suppose.
You didn't read classic illustrateds when you were young, Tale of Two Cities, and I mean, all the visuals that you talk about, Madame Defarge, I know exactly what she looks like, knitting her scarves, you know, thanks to the graphic novel. Used to be called classic illustrated in my days.
Les Miserables, David Copperfield.
Yeah. I rest my case.
Yeah. Tom Sawyer, Julius Caesar.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but Jayant is right. I mean, see, this whole rebranding of Will Eisner, I think, used it first time. Nobody knows who used that word graphic novel. It kind of has gained currency, and it's just now, it's sort of My book Corridor was like, it was published, it was self-described as a graphic novel. The Penguin marketing team thought that it's a good way to describe sort of itself, and it was also part of like global. The ones that came before did not describe it themselves as graphic novel. Does that mean they're not graphic novels? Hardly so. So yeah, what Jayant is saying is basically, also like basically, it's an important point. It talks about like the ridiculousness of the genre definitions, which you are not responsible for. I am somewhat.
I wanted to add to this.
But you know, adaptation is an interesting thing. We did. I was a small time publisher, precariously small time, so precarious that the publishing house doesn't exist anymore. But we were trying to adapt. Our next stage. We first asked these journalists to get together with. So I will be talking about that. Your experience of like talking to Dennis Lilly, for example, could have been a great comic book. So the next version was to kind of, you know, adapt important literature into comics. So we thought of Manusmriti. One, somebody has to understand why do we default to diabetes and conservative politics so easily? There must be at the heart of this, there must be something which is already there in our former text. So Manusmriti is what I thought of, like, you know, doing a serialized comic book on Manusmriti part. That's when we folded up. But somewhere, you know, some startup will probably pick it up. And so yeah, the adaptations does not necessarily have to be only Three Musketeers. I'm saying that the adaptations should be soon, like, I don't know, Sindhi short stories.
I want to add something to it. Perhaps on a lighter note, perhaps a little more seriously. If you notice, this is a hardcover. Now, last night we were discussing at this party, we were discussing about graphic novels, and I was being asked to explain what it is that I'm going to be talking about, since I knew so little about graphic novels. The point, Jayant, is very simple. Those days, whether it was Les Miserables, Tale of Two Cities, Anna Karenina, anything that was there, they were always in soft cover. They were totally unassuming. They believed that these were comic books. As my friends in St. Xavier's used to say, we looked at them. They didn't read them. What is happening is when you put it under hard cover, between covers like this, and discuss social issues, and you know, have your own set of caricatures and so on, I think perhaps it gets promoted to that. But I don't know when you came in, but if you remember, we said earlier that it began with things like, you know, Tintin, Asterix, a whole lot of... and you remember, Jayant, how you showed me a comic book of The Clockwork Orange, Burgess's book. I had seen the movie in London, and I came back and you told me, I'll show you this. And you were talking a language of the droogs. And that's the kind of influence it had, you know, the Tolchek, and how you're going to do this, and the Yahudis, and so on. Any other questions?
I like the description that it's basically underwear that decides what's a comic book and a graphic novel. Mm-hmm. That if you just give it a hard edge, hard cover, it could be.
any specific issues?
Sorry, Adil, I missed the last bit of your question.
And the book has also come out in Kindle.
Kindle. No, I suppose there are all these e-rights involved, so e-rights and things like that. But I mean, it's amenable to be read on Kindle. I might even add some sound to it, if that all, because it's a Kindle makes it easier to carry. I'll tell you what's happening right now in European trains. Like we're talking about inner city trains, like metro and tube. Reading bearded men reading old paperbacks is supposed to be the sexiest thing to be. There are many articles written about smoky men in New York underground reading Moby Dick and stuff like that. So it's acquired, reading has, people lament about like people not reading, but reading has become a bit of a lifestyle. The number of sort of secondhand bookstores that have come up, it's phenomenally important. Children are also reading quite a bit. I know that there is all these other, children's also living kind of firsthand, but they also have many other, you know, children have a lot to say these days. They decide their own parties, they decide their own clothes, they decide on holidays and things like that. But I think, I don't think it's entirely true that children are not reading. And we all have to embrace these new technologies, these new animation and stuff like that.
So, if there's nothing else, there's a lady there.
I think it'll be a very bad idea to, I mean, there are two things. One is this idea and the second one is the question. But the idea to sort of have a graphic novella in Kindle will be really bad. I've tried reading graphic novels in Kindle and it does not work. You can't see anything clearly and it'll be a very wrong idea. But my question is, can you write about Delhi, draw about Delhi or whatever you like to use, whichever verb you like to use, compose about Delhi if you're not in Delhi? I'm just thinking as a practitioner, like, can I write about Calcutta when I'm not in Calcutta, you know?
It's a very good question. The distancing is phenomenally important. Like, for example, your imagination of city heightens when you are not in that city. If you've had a strong lived-in experience, it's likely that I can write about the haunted buildings of Calcutta than the haunted buildings of Lima, for example, because I don't know what Lima is like or whatever. The subject is interesting. And now, if I write that haunted building of Calcutta in Lima, sitting in Lima, it might actually give you a slight advantage over writing it whilst you are living in, if you're writing the same urban legends of like, because I have worked on a haunted building. My father worked in a, I have worked on a haunted building where my father worked in that haunted building. And the 12th floor of the building was considered to be a place where people would just spontaneously jump from. Well, there was one, sometimes halfway through drinking tea, because there was this amazing fifth floor terrace which grew begonias. Anyway, so all your sensibility, the architecture gets phenomenally amplified inside your head, you know, there's sort of imaginary. And anyway, you're not trying to get into complete reality. You might write drawn Malviya Nagar and looks like Parsons Green, but the fact is that your sensibilities are kind of clued into that. And I think often, you know, I don't know about you, but often don't you feel that if you've experienced something really interesting, it's only in retrospect that experience can be felt. Because if you're having a great time, you're not like basically doing kabbo around it. You're not like sort of hanging around and saying that, oh, amazing, like a breeze blowing through this fantastic sort of thing. I mean, it's a bit like, you know, it's not done. But in retrospect, you remember that particular walk or you remember that particular, you know, And I feel like staying away from a city if you're writing about it. It's kind of healthy. And staying what historically also, because it's not space, it's also time. If you're removed time-wise, so if you're writing about Bahadur Shah Zafar's Delhi, of like how like people would go from Delhi College, from one Mushaira to another Mushaira, panch chabate chabate telte telte, kind of a feeling. I mean, Delhi is still like that. In parties, you go from one party to another party in semi-drunken state, eating pan, like slightly doing cross-country walking sort of thing. Nothing fundamentally has changed. But even if it's removed by time, I think it requires a degree of humanity to understand what happened. It's a good question.
Yeah, anyway. Closing comments, time to call it a day. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience and putting up with all some of the eccentricities that we presented. And my closing comment is to wish Sarnath Banerjee's book all the success, and leaving you with the thought that why not a graphic novel of 50 Shades of Grey?
Thank you.